Falcon 9 Double, Soyuz and PSLV for India, now on kNews. Hi, Lucas here, welcome to kNews and a big thank you to all my kNews boosters on Patreon. Before I come to this week's launches, there is one I didn't mention last week. Long March 3B, it launched on Sunday with a Chinese communication satellite called ChinaSat 9A. The sad news is, the upper stage didn't perform nominally and ChinaSat was not delivered into its planned geosynchronous transfer orbit. However, the spacecraft is safe and in a stable orbit nonetheless. It will still be able to achieve its final destination, burning more fuel than anticipated, but this will decrease its lifespan from its initial 15 down to a not disclosed amount. I guess that's better than losing it entirely. India is at it again, this time launching its smaller PSLV or Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle. It's currently scheduled for June 23rd at 3:59 UTC and will take place at the Satish Dhawan Space Center in India. Launching in its XL configuration, it will use 6 of its bigger boosters and 4 core stages as usual. What I found out by accident is how they steer their first stage with. The most common principle for KSP players is engine gimballing. PSLV uses that too on its upper stages, but a so-called secondary injection thrust vector control on its first stage. How this works is it carries additional tanks on the sides which fire a liquid into the booster's nozzles, changing the thrust. If one side has more thrust than the other, the rocket will begin to rotate naturally. This is, by the way, also called differential thrust. This works with strap-on boosters but also without. Not using these, however, it needs additional tanks so it can fire its liquid from 4 different sides into the single core nozzle. I love this and I think KSP needs it as well. Having a separate gimballing liquid means it has no impact on the fuel consumption, which would otherwise lead to an uneven fuel distribution. I think it would be a great addition to the game since it also comes with a downside, the added mass, which makes it not overpowered. Back at PSLV, it has, as mentioned, 4 core stages and again a lot of payload up top. I think at this point one can really call this rocket a hitchhiker's ride to the galaxy. Next to the main payload, Cartosat 2, there is the Indian University satellite and it will also carry 29 CubeSats for countries all around the world. After liftoff, the rocket will first head east and then sway to the south to avoid flying over land and shoot its payload into a polar orbit, which has an inclination of 90 degrees or 97 for that matter. While the rocket goes through its staging, let me give you some more details about the payload. Cartosat will, as the name indicates, perform cartographic tasks, taking a lot of pictures from the ground from a roughly 500 km high orbit. Now, there are too many smaller satellites on board to talk about all of them, but since one of them is German, I'll go with that. Totally unbiased. You can, by the way, tell the satellite is German by the inspirational name QB50DE04 or Cube50 Deutschland 4. That sounds as if it was named by a labeling machine. Jokes aside, at least the bus or platform the CubeSat uses has a nice nickname, Compass 2, which is also developed at the Aachen University in Germany. Despite its rather boring name, the satellite is actually pretty interesting. It has a drag sail on board, which it will deploy in orbit to test a fast and efficient deorbiting. This technology could be key in the future, where SpaceX and other companies will shoot thousands of satellites into a low Earth orbit to cover the planet with internet. So, thank you and good luck, Aachen! Next to launch is a Falcon 9 on the same day at 18:10 UTC. However, it was delayed from last week and I have already covered that one in the last episode. Still, if there will be no further delays, we could see 2 Falcons launch within 2 days. But before I come to the second Falcon launch, there is a Soyuz which wants some attention as well. It is also scheduled for June 23rd, but there is no exact T0 yet. It will probably launch somewhere in the evening from Plesetsk in Russia. This time, really in Russia. In the last episode, I actually claimed Baikonur to be in Russia too, but it is of course in Kazakhstan. Sorry about that. As you can probably already tell by the animation, this will be a rather special Soyuz launch. Version 2.1V uses no side-mounted boosters and the core engine is replaced by an NK-33, which was the Russian moon rocket's engine, developed in the 1960s. The first stage tank is also modified, but I think they actually used the booster attachments up top to secure the rocket on the launch pad, but I'm not sure on that one. At least, it's held by 4 arms at roughly the same location. It would make sense though if the rocket had some extra structural integrity where the boosters push against. Anyways, up top is a Russian satellite, which I have no idea how to pronounce. It's military as far as I can tell, so there is also not much information available. So, since the launch is rather secret, I can only speculate where it will be going, but launching from Plesetsk, it will probably head north to also achieve a polar orbit. And finally, the last launch this week will be a second Falcon 9 on June 25th at 20:25 UTC, and it will not lift off from Cape Canaveral but Vandenberg on the US west coast. If this launch sounds familiar to you, it's because on the upper stage is the second set of 10 satellites for Iridium. The first set launched earlier this year, and I also made a kNews special about the Iridium constellation, so feel free to check this one out if you would like to know more. Judging by the flappy wings and landing legs, the Falcon booster will attempt to land again, but this time on the drone ship, just read the instructions. The twin of course I still love you. Launching from Vandenberg, the rocket will head south and also go for a polar orbit. I think we can call this one the Polar Week. A little over 2 minutes into the flight, the booster will separate and perform its one-of-a-kind maneuver to aim itself like a ballistic missile towards the drone ship. Instead of smashing into it, however, which it will hopefully not do, it will ignite some of its engines and unfold its landing legs to come to a full stop just when it touches down. What I find quite astonishing is that so far SpaceX nailed every single landing, which is not an experimental one. They got rid of the experimental designation some time ago, and since then every failed landing can be treated as a partial mission failure. They need those boosters back because they already make deals with their partners for using used boosters, so the more they have in stock the better. The launch earlier this week will use such a used booster, actually the one of the previous Iridium mission. And Iridium itself recently also indicated that they would use these too, but they want a bigger discount it seems. However, I don't think this is how it works, since the one who pays the most for flying with a used booster gets it. And as long as there are people willing to go with a stock discount, I doubt anyone will get more, but who knows. A special deal for Iridium who launches so many satellites would be fair too, I guess. Another thing to look for, by the way, are the fairings. SpaceX mounted some RCS thrusters on them to control the descent and probably uses parachutes to land them. I'm not quite sure on that though. They didn't release any footage of that yet, so I have some hopes we will see that for the first time this week. Once the upper stage is done with its final burn, all 10 Iridium satellites will be released, and so will hopefully all the other payloads from the other rockets. Good luck to everybody! Okay, that shall conclude episode 90, and I hope to see you next one if you like. Auf Wiedersehen and thank you for watching!